So now we come to the Dhamma talk. Today it's about consciousness, how to raise your consciousness, how to develop the higher levels of consciousness. According to the dictionary, consciousness is a state of being aware and responsive to one's surroundings, a person's awareness of perception of something. In the famous book, The Grand Chessboard, Brzezinski says this: if you have, let's say you have a ball-sized consciousness, if you read a book, you have that much of understanding. If you look out of a window, you have that much of awareness. And when you wake up in the morning, you have that much of wakefulness. Now let's say you would be able to expand this consciousness, then whenever you read a book, you have more understanding. Whenever you look out of your window, you have more awareness. And whenever you wake up in the morning, you have more wakefulness. So we are all possibility. Everything we do, we think, we speak, is conditioned by our consciousness. So whatever we do, first it starts at the conscious level, and then we express it in words, in actions, or even in thoughts. So whatever we do, speak, or think is an expression of our consciousness, which is awareness, energy of being, and it can be developed through mindfulness or vipassana meditation. So here it will become very clear why vipassana meditation is so powerful. So in vipassana meditation, we use awareness and mindfulness to understand the workings of the mind. So we develop more and more awareness, and consciousness is nothing else than awareness. Cetta vimutti is another term from the Buddha, means mind liberation. Cetta means the mind or the core consciousness, and vimutti means deliverance or liberation. When it comes to the term consciousness, we have three terms which are coming close to the word consciousness. One is vijnana, most probably the closest one. Citta means consciousness or the mind. And manas also means consciousness or the workings of the mind. So all these three terms are sometimes used by the Buddha to point at consciousness, but especially vijnana is the word he uses the most. America used to be known as land of the free and land of the brave. It's a role America has lost long ago, and I have great respect for Australia, and I believe Australia could be the next land of the free and land of the brave. So we can see Australia is turning very much spiritual, and it is going very well compared to all the other countries. So I believe Australia has a great future. If they continue on the spiritual path, it could be very well the future land of the free, land of the brave. The famous Thomas Jefferson said this: I have sworn eternal hostility against every form of tyranny over the mind of man. He was the third president of America and also the principal author of the Declaration of Independence. So he was really a great man. And you can also see in the beginning when they started the United States of America, it was started with great ideas. So people had a lot of freedom, independent thoughts, independence of thinking. And that's why America developed within a very short time into this powerful country. So reality, coming back to the matrix idea, so the Buddha says reality is ultimately an illusion. So our reality, the ego, the I, mind, belief, is ultimately an illusion, and it can be shed through meditation. Once the I or the ego belief has dissolved, what remains is pure consciousness, what the Buddha called the Buddha nature or the consciousness within. So this isn't real. What is real? How do we define reality? As many meditators have reported, once you do wake up in your meditation, you realize that this reality is an illusion. What remains is consciousness or unlimited consciousness. the unbound consciousness where you know everything, you see everything, you can be at different places at the same time. So there are no limitations for consciousness. But as soon as we are reborn, consciousness having a human experience, we are limited by the six senses, we are limited by this human existence. So where is consciousness located? If you ask people, where is your consciousness? They will point at the head, at the head or at the heart. And now it is very clearly proven that the consciousness is neither in the head nor in the heart. It is non-local. So your consciousness is not residing within the body. That's why there are also practices where you can take out your consciousness, go on an astral journey and bring it back again. So it is not located within your body, but it is closely related with your brain and with your mind. To prove this, now there have been many tests done, and I don't agree with the tests because they were cutting up small worms, but it proved the point. So in what they did here, there's a certain type of worm which has the ability, if you cut off the head, including the brain, it grows back. So it can grow back the whole head, including the brain. And also the peculiarity of this worm is it is afraid of blue light. Don't know why, it doesn't like blue light, but it's very fond of eating liver. It likes to eat liver. So the test has been done. They put a blue light on and they put a piece of liver, and after a while, this creature overcomes the fear of the blue light, goes over and eats the liver. Now it takes a while till the worm is used to do that. So till it is ignoring the blue light, it's walking over and eating the liver. What they did after that, they cut off the heads. And after, you can see, 14 days, the head, including the brain, grows back. And even after that, they ignored the blue light, crawled straight over to the liver and started eating it. So this memory that they need not to worry about the blue light was still there. Also the brains and with the head was completely severed and cut off. So when it grew back, the memory was still there. So the question is, where did this memory reside? So the memory was in the consciousness, which is not located within the the body of the worm. It is in the memory with the karma. Everything is located in the consciousness. Next question, are animals and trees conscious? Now, when it comes to animals, we are fairly sure they have consciousness, also it is more limited than the human consciousness. They don't have that much free will as human beings have. When it comes to trees, because I was recently reading this book, The Hidden Life of Trees, thanks to Yasmin, and it was a very interesting read, and what they argue out is that even trees are conscious. So they give a lot of proof that there are electrical impulses going to the roots of the tree. The tree feels, remembers, reacts, and even defends themselves. They also communicate with other trees and they start warning others and they prepare if danger arises. Especially one story in the book is very interesting. It's about the giraffes in Africa, and there's a certain tree, acacia tree, which the giraffes like to eat this type of leaves. So when they start eating at the tree realizes there is a danger and it starts producing chemicals, very bitter juices in the leaves, so that the giraffes don't feel like continuing eating anymore. So it's not tasty for them anymore. So they move on to another tree. Not only that, the tree also sends out some scents warning all the other trees around them. And so they all start producing the same chemical and the leaves all turn bitter. So much so that the giraffes know that already. So when the leaves turn bitter, they do not go just to the next tree. They go like 100 meters away to another tree, hoping that that one will not have got the message yet. And so much so that the giraffes try also to go against the wind because they know the message will arrive there a little later. And so the question again arises, who makes these decisions? So the tree feels there is danger, it decides to do something, and it protects itself. And also it sends out some message to all the others, be careful, danger is coming. So according to that, even trees have some kind of consciousness. And so consciousness may be in many different places we would not think of. So even animals, trees, human beings, definitely spiritual beings have consciousness. When scientists start to probe into consciousness, they usually start studying the brain, because there's a very close correlation between the consciousness and the brain. It does not mean that they think now consciousness is inside the brain, but only because it's closely connected with the consciousness, they can study brain functions and through that get some idea of how consciousness is working. One study has been done in the, it's called the Triune Brain. The reason, and in this study it says, the reason human behavior is so strange is that we have not one, but three brains. The three brains are incompatible, and also they try to work together, often they fail. These are the three brains. So the lowest one is called the reptilian brain, the other is the mammal brain, and the highest one is the rational brain. The lowest one is often compared to a crocodile brain. So basically it has just a few switches. One is attack or run away, sleep or reproduce. It has just a few switches. It doesn't have any higher thinking. The second one, the mammal brain, is often compared to a horse brain. It's all about feelings, how you feel. I feel good, I feel bad, I don't like this feeling, I don't like that feeling. So it's all concerned about how you feel or about your emotions and pleasure and pain. The highest one is the real human layer, where the higher logical thinking is going on. So this is the real human layer of your brain. So all these three are slightly connected, but not as much as you would think. And often the problem is that not the highest brain is controlling all the lower brains, it's the other way around. Especially in moments of danger, usually the lowest, the reptilian brain, is taking over. It can also save your lives. Let's say a car rushes towards you and is about to hit you, so you jump away from the street without even thinking. So that is the reptilian brain taking over. In that lower function, there is no thinking, you just react to outside. The problem is, if you always are mainly working on that level, we don't think about things, we block out the logical thinking, we are just reacting to impulses from outside. And as it is mentioned in this study, people mostly use brain number one and two, and rarely trouble brain number three. And the three means is the human layer where the real intelligence lies. But because we are always afraid from something, we are scared of something, so we work on the level one and two, we hardly ever go to the level number three, which you develop in meditation or spiritual practices. If you're on the second level, often emotions hijack our higher mental functions. So then the emotions start ruling your being, and again, you don't use your logical thinking. Or you stay in the reptilian brain, which is, it has a few characteristics. One is rigid, obsessive, compulsive thinking, also ritualistic and paranoid ideas. It's prone to repetitive programmed behavior with little evidence of learning from mistakes. And if you look at society, many are functioning on that level. It's all just about might is right, let me go first. And so all the emotions are blocked out, and higher thinking is also blocked out. So basically, a human being is, there's an animal layer, there's a human layer, and there's a divine layer in our brain. What we should do is to control the animal behavior, to develop the human layer, and to become divine or real spiritual beings. So the transcendence of the ego and the development of consciousness. So our minds are all we have. Happiness and unhappiness, joy and misery, it's all in our mind. It's all we ever had, and they are all we can offer to others or offer to society. Every experience you have ever had has been shaped by your own mind. So the transcendence of the ego and the development of consciousness is possible through spiritual practices and through meditation. The result is more awareness, more consciousness, or just being in the present moment. So once you transcend this ego, this I, me, or mine belief, automatically you develop the higher consciousness, what the Buddha called the Buddha nature. So spiritual experiences also tell us nothing about the cosmos. Let's say you have really an experience in your meditation. It does not say anything about the universe or the cosmos. It does not say anything about divine origin or certain holy books. It does not prove any religious dogma, but it tells you something about your consciousness. It tells us something about the possibility of human experience. Religion usually does, it tries to make a point. So whenever somebody from a particular religion has a spiritual experience, then they usually say, ah, that is proving our point, that is why we believe in our type of spirit or God. But actually the experience is universal and does not prove any particular dogma or religion. Or as Mahatma Gandhi said, God has no religion. The Dharma, spirituality, consciousness is beyond all dogmas and religions. Follow only your own experience, as mentioned in the famous Kalama Sutta. Believe nothing, no matter where you read it or who said it, no matter if you or if the Buddha himself said it to you, unless it agrees with your own reason and with your own common sense. So don't believe in anything. The term in Buddhism is called ehipassiko. So try to find out for yourself. Trust only your own experience. Even when it comes to Buddhist meditation, some say Buddhist meditation does not have a Buddhist copyright. And the reason is because there are now many non-sectarian approaches like the Vipassana meditation, mindfulness meditation. I think in Melbourne you have an Insight meditation group. So all this is presenting only the technique of how to develop your mind, how to work with your mind, without even the Buddhist layer, without any religion involved. And like in the case of Mr. Goenka, who started this Goenka Vipassana meditation centers worldwide, he purposely presented it in a way they don't have even a Buddha statue there. So all he says in the beginning is, this system comes from the Buddha, but it is non-sectarian, everybody can do that. And because they present it in a non-sectarian way, everybody feels like coming there. And I have been to many of these retreats. There are Muslims, Hindu, Christians, Buddhists, all sitting together, practicing this Vipassana meditation. Now we are in the age of Aquarius. Aquarius stands for cleansing, discovering, experience. Everything comes to light at this age, everything will be experienced. Even the vibrations are changing in favor of spirituality. Because more and more people are turning now spiritual, newcomers, somebody who decides to start with meditation now, finds it much easier to get into meditation and start with spiritual practices. So also one sign of this age is cleansing, so you clean your psyche. So if we do not clean our physical bodies and also our minds, it will be very difficult to develop the higher consciousness. So we have to start somewhere with our spiritual practice. Also we know our consciousness is not located within our body, but the body and mind is where we start with any kind of spiritual practice. Like for example the Indian Brahmins. Now I'm not fond of the caste system in India, but the Brahmins have some very good quality, and that is they are obsessed with purity. So when it comes to the food and the way they practice their spiritual practices, they are obsessed with purity. That's why they developed these yoga and meditation systems. to purify the mind and the body and prepare the mind and body for higher consciousness. Cruelty against nature, what we see now worldwide is more and more exploitation of humanity and also of our Earth. So we can see the cruelty against nature everywhere, a global society or a global elite concerned only about themselves. The selfish approach cannot succeed, cannot last for long. So we have to do a rethinking. A rethinking will be very much necessary. But because I travel a lot and meet a lot of different people, I can see that humanity actually is going in the right direction. But the problem is the rulers. So they who are sitting up there, they are of course very comfortable, and for them it's just fine as it is. But that selfish approach, just for me, just for my, and not caring about others, that I think is also coming to an end right now. Times are changing, people are waking up. Now, one way of purifying yourself is about a vegetarian life. And also, I'm just presenting here my own opinion. I'm a vegetarian for 27 years now. And I give you just my reasons, and I give you a few facts about the vegetarian life. Like the Indians in Brahmin, the Brahmins in India, for example, they are pure vegetarians, and I heard if you offer a piece of meat to a Brahmin, he will feel insulted. So for me, there are four main reasons why I am a vegetarian. One is compassion, the other is the health reason, there's a spiritual reason, and humanity, or to help humanity. Compassion is, I do not like that animals are killed so that I have something to eat. Let's say if it would be 100% necessary, it would be something different, but since I don't think it is necessary, I don't see any reason why anybody should kill animals just for me to have something to eat. The second reason, health reason, now many doctors and scientists agree now that our human body is made to digest fruits and vegetables mainly. So meat and fish is not really our natural food. Our whole digestive system is not made to digest meat. And so it creates a lot of diseases like heart disease and cholesterol. And so the main cancer, the main sicknesses we have nowadays, many are caused just by eating meat and fish, since our body, it does not completely agree with our body. The other reason is spirituality, so it's a more finer reason. If you kill an animal at the last moment, it will not be happy, to say it simple. So it will be angry, it will be scared, it will, some negative emotions will be there. You can imagine if you are about to be killed, you will not be happy. You will be, some negative emotions will run through your system. So in these negative emotions, we eat together with the meat. So on a spiritual level, it affects us negatively. So it is not very helpful for meditation. But it does not mean, and if somebody is eating meat or fish, he can make some progress in meditation, but I think it will take longer. And maybe he will not go that far. The last reason is humanity, and this one I added just recently. So far I had only three, that's the last one. So if you decide to be a vegetarian, you will save thousands of lives, and I will explain this a little bit later. So if the, let's say whole humanity would be vegetarian, there would be plenty of food for everybody. Because we produce meat, there is a lot of waste in this process. To produce a kilo of meat, you need like hundreds of, I come to that later. So you need a lot of resources to produce 1 kilo of meat. And so if all would be vegetarian, there would be plenty of food for all the people in Africa and Asia. Nobody would have to suffer a lack of food. Or as it said here, the world hunger is getting ridiculous. There's more fruit in a rich man's shampoo than in a poor man's plate. And the estimates say cutting meat by 10% worldwide would feed 100 million people. Meat eliminating will end starvation forever. And if they say if everybody would have a Western diet, let's say all American, European, Australian diet, then we would need two planets. Otherwise, it's not enough for everyone. So nowadays, we have 1 billion hungry people and 1 billion overweight people. And so in the West, people die because they eat too much. And in the other part, they don't have enough, so they die from hunger. So definitely something is wrong with these systems. We have to do some rethinking. It is said every day 35,000 children die every day from hunger and preventable diseases. So, and all this could be avoided if the whole world would be vegetarian. Another big point is, now at the water, Australia knows this very well, the future oil will be water. And now many of the oil corporations, they don't buy oil fields anymore, they buy land with lots of pure water. Because they know in future water will be like, will have the price of gold, and it will be more valuable than oil. So the future will be a huge scarcity of water worldwide, and if we don't have enough pure water, that will lead to even more starvation and suffering. Coming back to the piece of meat, so it is estimated that you need 15,000 liters of water to produce 1 kilo of beef. And these are low estimates. I have heard up to 50,000, so they are not 15,000 is already a low estimate, which you need to produce 1 kilo of beef. Here, land needed for the production of 1 kilo of food. So you can see vegetable, potato, fruit needs very little, compared to eggs, chicken, pork, and beef, which needs a lot more land, water, and resources. So you are guilty, the piece of meat is guilty, to make us sick, to make us cruel, to make us unspiritual, and to make us lose our compassion. Or as Albert Einstein said, nothing will benefit health and increase the chance for survival on Earth as the evolution to a vegetarian diet. So you also could see it's not a small step for humanity, it will be a huge step forward. Every time you eat or drink, you are either feeding disease or you're fighting it. And there's one American doctor, he wrote about the vegetarian diet, and he's very fond of it, let's say so. He said this, if you are fond of a meat-rich diet, you better live close to the next hospital. Because meat gives you cancer, heart disease, and a whole lot of other diseases. And there's one discourse in the Buddhist, from the Buddha, where he says, before human beings started eating meat, there were only three diseases in the world. Once humans started eating meat, we had hundreds of diseases coming from this unhealthy diet. Now, Buddhism and vegetarianism, unfortunately, Buddhists are divided about this topic. That's why it's also a little bit difficult to talk about it. About, at least in Theravada, let's say Theravada Buddhists, are about half of them say, actually, you should be a vegetarian. If you read the Metta Sutta, the loving kindness with all living beings, it looks like you should be a vegetarian. The other half says, just eat whatever you get, don't be choosy, just eat it. And so that's why the Buddhists are a little bit divided on that. But the Mahayana Buddhists, or the Chinese Buddhists, they take it very strictly, they're strict vegetarians. And I heard in Mahayana Buddhist monks, they have an extra rule. If a monk eats a meat, they chase him out of the temple and ask him never to come back again. So they take it really very serious. In Theravada, we have both opinions. So the eating of meat extinguishes the seed of great compassion by the Buddha. But I must be fair to say, this is not Theravada, this is from Mahayana Buddhism. And they have Mahayana Buddhist texts where they say the Buddha was 100% vegetarian and he did not approve eating meat and fish. And this saying below there is a German saying, it sounds much better in German, that's why I kept it. Du bist, was du isst. And the meaning is you become what you eat, you are what you eat. And so if I eat something pure, I become pure. If I eat something impure, I become impure. Also from the sorry. Also some people say, if I don't eat meat and fish, where will I get my protein from? I hear this all the time. Where do I get my protein? I cannot survive without eating meat and fish. I want you to meet Mr. Patrick Bohomian, a pure vegetarian. Look at his body. And he is known to be the strongest man in Germany. He's Iranian, originally from Iran, living in Germany, and he is known as the strongest man in Germany, pure vegetarian. And there are hundreds of examples. You just Google vegetarian muscle man. You will find many which prove that the proteins do not come only from meat and fish. So there are many vegetarian diets which have more protein than a piece of meat. And as the pure vegans say, everything the human being or the human body needs is growing out of the ground. So you don't need anything from the animal, you don't need the animals for your food. Anything the human body needs to stay healthy and strong grows out of the ground. So saving Earth, saving humanity, many people ask me, what can I do? How can I make a change? And now, one, I always say, do some meditation, then through your vibrations, you will change the world automatically. But this is another good way of changing the world. You do not even need to leave your home. You do not have to spend even $1. Actually, you will save money just by the decision to become a vegetarian. You will save hundreds or thousands of lives because it is costs much less resources to produce a vegetarian meal than to produce a meal with meat and fish. So it's a very, it's a personal choice. I'm just presenting some information here. And so that would be one very good way if you want to do something for humanity. I never lose, also I present often negative things about what's going on in society and worldwide. I never lose hope in humanity. And this is Dabai Atkins, 11 years old. He is called the youngest yoga teacher in the USA. And he is teaching yoga, giving yoga retreats, and he does it for free. So whatever money he gets, he donates to a cancer charity for children. And he was big in the news in America. So there are people, even very young people, children, we have some children here today, so who have their heart at the right place, so they try to do something for humanity. They try to do something good and something useful with their lives. So all these stories are very give us a great, it's a great example for us that we also can do something. So whenever we do just a little kindness, we spread good vibrations, we do something out of compassion and kindness, little by little we can change this society. And to end this part of the vegetarian life, here's a saying from Bernard Shaw. He says, a man of my spiritual intensity does not eat corpses. And by Bernard Shaw, a great man. So coming back to ehipassiko, the term the Buddha used for not believing anything blindly. So the Buddha said, even if you find something what I say, or in the nowadays we have the Tripitaka, the holy books, only to say it is in the Tripitaka, that's why the Buddha did it, it is sure, it is proven, that's why I'm allowed to do it, is not really a proof. So what the Buddha meant with ehipassiko is doubt everything, use your own, trust only your own experience. Only if you experience it with your own five senses, then take it as something positive or something true. So we should never say it is in the book, that's why it's fine, don't question it. That is not Buddhism. So ehipassiko means try, find out for yourself. If you can see this is useful, then take it. If you see this is not helping me or humanity, then throw it out. So the Buddha nature, or this higher consciousness, is within us. Everybody has this higher spiritual consciousness, what the Buddha called the Buddha nature. Usually it is covered up with defilements, so greed, hate, and delusion is weighing down on it. So if we clean out our body and mind, what we do in meditation, so we purify our subconsciousness from all these negative emotions, then the Buddha nature starts shining. So if we realize that this ego is an illusion, that mind is an illusion, we have, for the practice, we have to start somewhere. So we start with purifying the body, we purify the mind, and then we can let the Buddha nature shine, or we attain stages of awakening. As the old Greeks used to say, pure spirit in a pure body, they believed if the body is not pure, the mind cannot be pure. And since the body, mind, and spirit, or the consciousness, are closely related, so we have to start with purifying body and mind first. When it comes to our existence, many, I say it's a dream, the Buddha said it's an illusion. So we should ask the big questions. Who are we? Are we just living in a dream-like state? Now there's an easy way to find out about it. So if you practice meditation, you work on your mind, sooner or later you will realize if this reality is real or not. And many people who woke up in their meditation through spiritual attainments, many times the first thing they said, now I see, now I woke up from this dream, now I woke up from this illusion. Or the famous saying from Mr. Goenka says, to see things as they are. So once we wake up, we will see what reality actually is. Again, we should not believe anybody, just try to find out for yourself. So experience, it's all about experience in the Buddhist teaching. The path to enlightenment is all about your own experience. Don't believe in books, traditions, or even when the Buddha said certain things. You should have an open mind, but very critical. So when you hear some new things, like a new meditation, some new insights, keep an open mind, but be very critical about it. Once you find out this is working, take it. Once you see it is proven to be wrong, just forget about it. Mr. Goenka said that once people come to his retreat and they find one small thing which they don't like, and I found one, like they don't do walking meditation, which I don't like. But he said it's like somebody offering you a plate of food with beautiful food on it, and there's one small piece in it, and you throw away the whole plate. The best thing would be you take out that small black thing, throw it away, and eat or enjoy the rest. So whenever we see something wrong in a certain teaching, it's not necessary that the whole thing is wrong. Maybe some parts are not true, and then you just take out these few things. So liberate your consciousness. There are several ways of experiencing expanded consciousness. Some are unintentional, it happens sometimes unintentionally. Some are quick approaches, what they call a shortcut, but they are unsafe. And there is an approach which is gradual and lasting. One way of experiencing higher consciousness is through near-death experiences. So many people who were clinically dead, the consciousness was moving out. They had this insight that they are pure consciousness, they could be in different places at the same time. They knew everything, the feeling was like real enlightened, unconscious, unlimited mind. But later they came back again, that's why they can tell about it. The other way is out-of-body experiences, and I'm reading this book right now, it's called Navigating the Out-of-Body Experience by Graham Nichols. And so you can train yourself to take consciousness out, take it on a journey and bring it back in again. Again, showing that consciousness is not limited to your body. Another way would be psychedelic experiences, and I as a Buddhist monk cannot recommend it. But one can have expanded consciousness experiences. And at least they are temporary. So also many say you can have a glimpse how enlightenment feels or how unlimited consciousness feels. But there are side effects and it could be potentially dangerous, and even the experience is only temporary. So after you come back and you are normal again. In the book from Sam Harris, I mentioned Sam Harris last time, he said this. He was 10 years in India as a strict meditator, and he tried also these type of things. And he said, yoga and meditation can be boring at times. So not every time you sit down in meditation, it is interesting. He said, potentially yoga and meditation could be boring sometimes. Psychedelics can be many things, but they cannot be boring. You can be sure about that one. But as I said, it can, there are side effects. It could be dangerous. It could mess up your mind. And the effects are only temporary. So the safe, the slow, safe, but once you get the permanent experiences, you get the meditative experiences. So it's called the gradual way, but the safe way. And once you make some real, you get some real results, the effect is usually permanent. So you can realize expanded types of consciousness, which we call stages of awakening or stages of enlightenment. What we do in meditation, we break up the ego illusion. Once you let go of the ego, the consciousness or the Buddha nature starts shining. So to awaken the consciousness is the main purpose of the Buddhist teaching. Try to be limitless in your meditation. And as I said, many people who made some actual progress, they say consciousness can be unlimited. A state of mind which, unless you are there, it would be difficult even to imagine. But according to the Buddha and all the saints, these types or the stages of awakening are possible. It all needs just energy and time into your meditation. Everybody has the potential of going there. Also, the Buddha never claimed to be a god or some spirit. He was born a human being just like us. He had maybe higher paramis, that means higher experiences from the past. But he did it all on his own, so he made a decision to leave his home, to start with meditation. He also didn't know how to do it, that's why he tried many different things. It took him 6 years of practicing the wrong way, till he realized there is another way. And only after 6 years of torturing his body and going through all kinds of hardships, he attained Buddhahood or full enlightenment. And so in many ways, also we may not have the parami of a Buddha, but in many ways for us it is easier because we know the path already. The Buddha has tried out for us many different things till he found the right path, what he called the middle path. So the path between sense enjoyments and self-torture, the middle path of attainment. There's one movie which you see up there, it's called Limitless. And the story is again about a guy who takes some experiential drugs and gets this unlimited consciousness feeling, or he's in that state of mind. And also many meditators who made actually some progress say, watch that movie and you get an idea how it feels when you are really enlightened or on the way to enlightenment. So you can watch that one. Yoga vichayadipuri, the saying of the Buddha, without meditation there will be no wisdom and there will be no liberation. So it's all about your practice. We can study the Buddhist texts, we can learn it by heart, we can teach it day and night. That alone will not liberate us. So we have to actually sit down, start with the meditation, start with the practice. And the nice thing about this practice is you don't need anything from outside. It doesn't cost you anything. You sit down at a quiet place. All you need is a quiet place and your mind. You just use awareness and mindfulness and you can attain all the stages of awakening. So with that, I come to the end of this Sunday Dhamma talk. So I hope there were a few points for you which will be interesting or which you can introduce in your spiritual practice. So may you all be well and happy, find peace and happiness in this very life. May you also be able to continue your Dhamma path. May you be able to make quick progress in your meditation and experience unlimited consciousness. Sadhu, sadhu. Also, if you're interested, please watch my website. There are some guided, because somebody asked, they want some small guided meditations. Sometimes when you start with meditation on your own, it's sometimes very difficult to keep the mind focused. So if you have a little guided meditation, and there are some 10 or 15 minutes small guided meditations, so if you just sit down and you play the guided meditation, some is much easier to go into concentration and to be mindful. Once you are used to it, you don't need any guided meditation anymore. You can sit anywhere and do your own meditation. So there are a few guided meditations there, and also some small talks about meditation. And some ask, why does the guy have a sword? The sword is a sign for wisdom. The Buddha compared a sword or a knife to wisdom. It is sharp like a sword, and you can cut out the negative emotions and also make a sharp cut and do the right thing in your life. So it's only symbolic. With that, we come to the question and answer session. There is just shortly about the Dhamma Dogga gave last Sunday. The Buddha's term for free will is attakara. It means one's own actions, self-initiative or free will. And it comes from a sutta which is called the Devadaha, not Devadatta, but Devadaha Sutta in the Majjhima Nikaya, where the Buddha discusses with the Nigandhas. This is where the ascetics at that time in India. And the Nigandhas had the idea that everything is conditioned by your past karma. So whatever happens to you now, it's all conditioned. You have no free choice. It's all. And they thought the only thing you can do not to do any new karma and to suffer. So you torture your body to pay off the old karma, not to do any new one, and that will lead to enlightenment. The Buddha did not agree with that. The Buddha said your karma or your present experience is a combination of the results of past karma plus the present actions. So it is conditioned by your past karma, but you have a choice. So it depends on how you react to this past karma. I can either enjoy it, I can reject it, or I can just note it with equanimity. So there's a different way. So there's a free choice. And last time we said maybe you don't have 100% free choice, but experts say about 30% maybe have choice. There is a free will, and you can change. You can make the wise choice, either do this or do that. And the Buddha also said, if there would be no free will or no free choice at all, there would be no possibility of getting enlightened or of freeing yourself from this existence. Only because there is a choice, there is free will, we have a chance to escape from this reality. That's only short about the last Dhamma talk. Going back. So now, do we have any questions about the Dhamma talk today? Please feel free to ask anything. Dishnadan always said, children first. If the children want to ask something, ask now. And when Dishnadan asked once about the questions, one kid got up and he asked him, are you enlightened? And if yes, how? And he gave a good answer. He didn't answer it straight away. But so do we have any questions? Please ask now. Can switch it on. Yeah.
Thank you, Bhante. I'm not sure if I've understood, but would the take-home message be that we really can't pinpoint where consciousness is?
Sorry, say again. I didn't.
We really can't pinpoint where consciousness is. It's not in any place.
We cannot pinpoint. Yeah, yeah. There are many tests, as far as they can, they try to find out, and they say it is not local. There have been other tests done with the human brain, like not intentional, but there were some people had some accidents, and they took out certain parts of the brain, and basically every part has been taken out in different on different people. And the memory was still there, so the whole memory and the whole consciousness was still there, so showing it is not local, it's not in your brain, not in your heart, it's not in your body, but consciousness is something non-material, so it is usually connected with your being, But like this out-of-body experiences also, intentionally you can take it out. And some people say that's what you do in dreams automatically. Each time you go into a dream, consciousness is going out, going into other dimensions, has different experiences, and in the morning it reconnects again. So according to that, consciousness is not limited to your body. It's not local. You cannot say it's here or here or here. It's not based in your body, but it is closely connected with your brain. So whatever consciousness does, it has an effect on your brain. But it's not residing inside your body. That's right, yeah. That's how I see it. Yeah, thank you. Any other question? Behind there.
Can you please describe what universal consciousness is?
Yeah.
Is it the same as unlimited consciousness?
Unlimited, yes, it's the same like unlimited consciousness. That's the dharma I'm using. So, as I said, the Buddha talked about Buddha nature or enlightenment is an unlimited consciousness state. That's the dharma I'm using. You can say enlightenment or unlimited experience, unlimited Buddha nature, nirvana, enlightenment. There's another term the Buddha used, Uttari Manusha Dhamma. Now it means a superhuman state of mind. So it's not the ordinary state of mind, it's something beyond that, some higher realized state of mind, which I call universal consciousness. Yeah. So unlimited, universal, unbound would be all the same term. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anything else? Oops. No question online, okay. Then if we don't have any more questions, then we stop for today. So I will do a short chanting at the end to bless you all. So I'm very happy that so many of you came today. It's a very nice way of starting the Sunday. You're also all welcome to join us on the other side for the lunch. So I do the chanting to bless you all and may you have a very nice Sunday today. Sabitiyo vivacantu saparogo vinasadu mati pavatvandarayo sugiri gayuko bhava bhavatu sapamangalam rakandu sapadivata sapabhutanubhavena sada sati bhavantuti apivadana silissa nichang vata bhajayinu chattaro dhamma vadanti ayuvarna sukangbalam Ayura rogya sambatti sakka sambatti mivacha Atto nippana sambatti iminadi samichatu Sadhu sadhu. So, thanks everybody for coming and have a nice Sunday. Thank you.